Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Paul Workman, and welcome to Drinking Age Movies Short, a show where we take a short look back at films that were released 21 years ago and discuss their impact on filmmaking and pop culture today. This week, we are saying happy 21st birthday to Dee Snider's Strangeland, a film that was released October 2nd, 1998.
And that, as much as anything else, led to my drinking problem.
Before we jump into Strangeland, we're going to take a look back at October 2nd to see what was released along with this and What Dreams May Come, the film that Jonathan and I covered on Wednesday's podcast, and this week's Too Damn Short. A Night at the Roxbury was the latest in line of Saturday Night Live sketch adaptations. It took a simple premise for a 5-minute sketch and stretched it into a 90-minute movie. It is most notable for being Will Ferrell's first starring role, Eva Mendes' first role on film, and Lonnie Anderson's final film role. Sorry you went out like this, Lonnie. You deserve so much better. This was DreamWorks' first computer animated film, and it starred every kid's favorite filmmaker, Woody Allen. I feel like I should say more things about this movie, but I'm just stuck wondering how much money Spielberg and Katzenberg gave Woody to be in this. You know, I never thought I'd cover Dee Snider on this show, but life's funny that way. Dee Snider was the lead singer and main songwriter of 80s hair metal band Twisted Sister. This band is most famous for their songs We're Not Gonna Take It and I Wanna Rock. A middling band to be sure, but Dee was more than a silly dude with curly hair who wore makeup, dressed in spandex, and shouted goofy defiant anthems for middle schoolers. He was also an eloquent spokesman for free speech in art and music. In 1985, he was one of the only three artists, along with John Denver and Frank Zappa, to stand up to the tyrannical overreach of Tipper Gore and the Parents Music Resource Center, the PMRC, a group of complete assholes if there ever was one. This last bit wasn't important to the story at hand, but I like it, so I put it in. What is important is that Snider wrote a song for Twisted Sister's third album, Stay Hungry, called, and follow me here, Horrortaria, parenthesis, the beginning, close parenthesis, colon, A, Captain Howdy, B, Street Justice. Dee Snider, congratulations, that's the worst title I've ever heard. This was released on the same album as We're Not Gonna Take It and I Wanna Rock, which is an album that has gone 3 times platinum and peaked at number 15 on the Billboard's Top 100 in the height of its popularity. An album that was popular enough to get the band this cameo in Tim Burton's Pee-wee's Big Adventure. I bring all of this up to illustrate that this wasn't some random song on some forgotten 80s album or random B-side slapped on a semi-popular single. This was track 4, side 1, on a record that over 3 million people bought, and it was the sole inspiration for Snider to dip his toe into the screenwriting world. While there are some differences from the song to the film, most of the plot stays the same. Dee Snider, also serving as producer on the film, gets the serial killer role of Carlton Hendricks. Hendricks is a man who visits local online message boards to find his victims under the name of Captain Howdy, a reference to the Ouija board scene in The Exorcist.
Captain who?
Captain Howdy.
Who's Captain Howdy?
You know, I make the questions and he does the answers.
Oh, Captain Howdy,
yeah, I see. Nice.
He is heavily into modern primitive subculture and tortures young girls with different forms of body modification. He is arrested, tried, and found not guilty by reason of insanity. This results in his incarceration in a mental facility for 3 years, at which time he is released, and the angry public takes vengeance into their own hands. The film was picked up by independent film company The Shooting Gallery, who are most famous for producing the Billy Bob Thornton film Sling Blade. This was going to be the flagship film for The Shooting Gallery's new separate horror logo, Raucous Releasing, which would mirror the Miramax Dimension labels. Snider's film was given $1 million and brought on director John P. Plow, who only had one other film under his belt, the Troama Films classic, Jurassic Women.
It is a good day when Troama is brought into a conversation.
According to an interview with Peaplow, he landed the job by flying to New York on his own dime and sitting down with Snider in the shooting gallery offices. When asked what he thought of Peaplow, Snider remarked, "Well, no one else has gotten on a plane, have they?" With a micro-budget of $1 million and the kitschy draw of a musician 10 years past his popularity, this film somehow still managed to flop. It only made $713,239 and drew some scathing reviews from critics. This turned out to be a really bad gamble for the shooting gallery because they would never release anything else under the raucous releasing banner, and after some poor management decisions and a string of flops, they would close their doors in 2001. This would be the last film that John Peaplow would direct. He would work in some commercial directing for years until he parlayed that success into a somewhat successful music career, opening for acts such as Huey Lewis in the News and Earth, Wind & Fire. Dee Snider has had some acting gigs in the last 21 years. His first film after this was playing himself in the 2002 VH1 original movie, Warning, Parental Advisory, about the PMRC hearings in 1985. Strangeland would spawn a prequel comic titled Dee Snider's Strangeland, Seven Sins, released by Fangoria Comics in 2007. It was written by none other than Dee's own son, Jesse Blaze Snider. Dee hasn't written another film in the last 21 years, though, with the cult following this film garnered, he is still trying to get a sequel off the ground. As late as 2015, production companies Imagi and TSG were going to produce, with Lionsgate set to distribute, but that has since fallen through. In 2017, he even released a video on Facebook claiming he would hopefully be working on it soon.
So like I just mentioned in passing, gearing up to hopefully go into production with Strangeland 2. I know I've talked about this for the last 20 years. I sound like a broken record.
No information for an upcoming production can be found at the time of this video. And I don't want anyone to forget his cameo in 2018's The Last Sharknado, It's About Time.
Because I will use any excuse to talk about Sharknado.
You got it all twisted.
Yeah, I think I know who's twisted, mister.
Last note of interest. This movie has had the distinction of being the most stolen video in the history of Blockbuster Video.
Wow, what a difference!
I'm not sure I would want people to know I rented, or worse, liked this movie either.
So that was Strangeland. Do you love it? Did you hate it? Do you want to rock?
I want to rock!
Rock!
Leave a comment down below and let us know all of that. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe, and hit that little bell icon to get some notifications, because I feel like I'm obligated to say that by now. You can follow us on Facebook at Drinking Age Movies. You can follow me, the Man of Constant Hatred, on Twitter and Instagram at Father of the Fear. You can give to our Patreon at patreon.com/drinkingagemovies. You can follow our podcast on Podbean, Stitcher, Spotify, and Apple Podcasts. And if you watch these videos and you listen to podcasts on something other than one of those, let us know in the comments and we will get it on that platform because we love you so much. My name is Paul Workman. I am the Man of Constant Hatred and you have yourself a damn fine day. Snider, who let that guy make a movie?
What?
Let's find out.